Pat.
Hey.
We got a voicemail from Jason Lollar. Yeah. Where are you going? Pat, come here.
Huh?
Come here. You have to listen to the voicemail from Jason Lollar. It's time we deal with this.
Doug and Pat, this is Jason Lollar. That's right, me, Jason Lollar. I wrote the book on pickups, you morons. Jason Lollar, I wrote the book, amigos. Pat, you're the one. You like to chase Oscar, huh? Maybe I should do some chasing of my own. Just come on down there and straighten you out. You want to be all resistance and inductance? I'll give you some inductance. Can I shove Oscar in the ass?
You're not Doug. You're Jason Lollar.
Yes, I am.
Okay, I actually am Doug. This is Pat. And believe it or not, this is Jason Lollar. Welcome here, Jason.
Thank you.
How cool is this? We've kind of had some fun with you a little bit. And maybe you've noticed
at my expense.
Well, yeah. Yeah. And some of the messages you left on our voicemail, that was rude. And some of the language you used, I'm sorry, sir. So, but you're here now, and it's great.
We'll put it all behind us. And move on.
Yeah.
Move on.
Jason has also brought... some pickups in some guitars, and we're going to play on those and talk about those. You probably are known as the pickup guru. You're the guy. You've got the book on it and the thing, because we've talked with other pickup makers, and they talk about you. They talk about you, and also you helping out, which could be good, could be bad.
Right.
But, what's up with that? Where did that come from, that this pickup interest that you had?
Well, you know, I went to a guitar making school in the 70s, Roberto Ben. Learned how to build guitars. And part of what we did was we made our own pickups. They showed us how to make those. And they were kind of like a Moserite pickup, which are really kind of really funky, really made out of like acetate and glued together with a wood core on the bobbin and really kind of sloppily... hand.
So that's when you were learning how to make?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so after I got out of that school, that was like 1979, I started building guitars, and I would make the pickups for them. And, of course, I also played a lot of gigs for a long time, and I spent more time doing that than building guitars for probably 15 years.
So you were playing gigs. Would you use your pickups and your guitars that you play gigs on?
Sometimes. Almost everything I made, I would sell because I don't want it hanging around. Some people are like...
Not a bad thing.
Yeah.
Some people are like, it's my baby. I can't let it go. But no, not me. Much more practical and get rid of it because the point is to... sell it and make another one.
Yeah, yeah, because you can.
Yeah,
yeah.
So.
And you're in Seattle area, which is so gracious that you would come down here in this horrible weather that we're having. Let's talk about some of the pickups that you brought down here, because this is really exciting. Besides the Imperial, so yeah. As everybody knows, we're like PAF kind of guys.
Right.
We like them, we play them, and all that, and the Lollar Imperial is a well-known PAF pickup. Yeah. But there's more that you do than just that, and we'll talk about the Imperial and plan them in a little bit.
Right.
Let's talk about this one.
This is the our... Just released this recently. It's our version of the old Gibson staple
right.
pickup. And basically what it is it's a P90, but it has, instead of a couple bar magnets with the steel adjustable poles, these pole pieces here with the bevels on them are the magnets. And that having the magnet inside of the coil instead of steel inside of the coil gives it a different sound.
Hmm.
And the shape of the pole piece also affects the sound, too.
Did you have people contacting you with an interest in this pickup?
Oh, yeah, for years. People have been asking for that. And a lot of what we make is in response to customer requests.
Yeah.
Over and over and over. When you start hearing something over and over, then it's worth looking into.
It's time to do it, yeah.
Yeah. We make this Charlie Christian pickup.
Yeah.
A lot of them are mounted in Telecasters. That was...
Yeah.
People asking for that because of Danny Gatton way back, you know.
Yeah.
That was...
Is that a real clear pickup? That would be a choice that somebody would put in it?
It's clear, but it also has a lot of bass, so mm-hmm. it's a fat, big fat sound.
Unlike
single
the pickup
coil.
That comes in those guitars.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's got more clarity and attack, but it's also real fat and smooth at the same time. But that was something that, you know, I figured we'd only make a few of, but over the years we've sold thousands of them, and you have to actually route the guitar to get it to fit in there.
Because the dimensions of that pickup are true
so
to the original.
Yeah, they're big. Uh-huh. Yeah.
With that big bar in there. This pickup is different than the original one, right?
Yes. This doesn't have the adjustable poles. The original one has a set of screws in between each pole that go down through a spring, and there's a press fit piece of brass, I think, that presses over the end of the magnet, and the screw goes down into that press piece that has a threaded.
Yeah.
And so you can adjust the poles up and down.
Yeah.
They're also longer.
Real, real long.
Yeah, they're really long. These are only about 7/8 long, so you can put that in a standard P90.
Right. When we first started talking about this, and I know that you were making a staple pickup, I was thinking that same thing. I go, geez, that sucker's like,
right?
It's really deep. So you've obviously compared the sound of the original staple, and then that's the sound you were going after.
Yes.
Uh huh.
It's really close, and it's a really nice compliment. Especially if you want to use the neck pickup a lot, you can, instead of getting muddy when you're playing on the neck pickup, it gives a little bit more point to it, a little bit more of a Fendery sound, but it still has that kind of growl that you get out of a P90. So it's not quite, you know. We also make it's called an alnico pole P90, which just has round alnico rods in it, and it sounds more kind of sort of like a Jazzmaster, whereas this retains some of the growl that you get out of that.
I guess this would be the right question. If it's not, then don't be surprised. What are these Alnico 5s?
They are Alnico 5, yeah.
Because that's, I think, what the originals were? I know they called, Gibson called them the Alnico.
Yeah, I don't know if it was 5 or 2 or 3, because the length of the magnet gives you a stronger field.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so a longer magnet is going to measure stronger. So I just measured it to make sure it was close to what the original was.
Our experience with these, I had a 56, played it a little bit, is that these things were sensitive. It's like we could pick up some strange overtones often by having that
it's too
magnitude close.
Oh yeah, for sure.
And all that stuff.
Yeah.
So without the adjustable pull pieces on there, you've obviously done some work here and got this so that it's balanced out.
Yeah, it works. If you were to raise it up too much, you can start to hear, starts to sound sour because it's pulling the overtones out of tune first. And then if you raise it even farther, you'll get kind of a weird helicoptering kind of.
Which, we're not saying that that's not a great sound.
That's the sound you're looking for. It's there.
Yeah.
There it is.
Yeah, if you want it.
Are these potted? Do you pot?
Yeah, these are potted for about 40 seconds. And what we do is I've gone through all of our different pickups, and they all are potted different amounts.
Oh.
And what happens is you probably heard somebody be playing their PAF from the 50s, and all of a sudden it becomes really microphonic and unusable. Have you ever heard of that?
We haven't had any of the PAFs that we've had ever do that, but...
Well, I hear from thousands of people.
Yeah.
And what happens is... You wind the coil really tight, and if you even if it's got tape around it, if you dropped it a little ways, the coil can just pop off and become all loose. So after years and years of vibrating, sometimes that, because the Gibsons were totally unpotted, the coil can shift, and then it becomes loose and it becomes overly microphonic where it's hard to use.
You mentioned something in your blog, which is if you're watching this, I'm assuming that you're geeky guys like us. Maybe that's overly cruel. But the blog you have on your website's fabulous. It just goes talks about, and one of the things that was talked about was the deterioration of the material in the coils themselves.
Yeah.
That was like, I was going, oh my God.
And the bobbins on the P90s, we get them in all the time where it's like speaker... Like the foam around the speaker, it just rots, you know.
Mm. Wow.
Oh, yeah. Eventually, they're all going to do that.
Yeah, yeah. They probably, when they were making them back in the day, they're going, hang on a second here. 60, 65 years from now, we're going to have a problem.
Right, exactly.
That probably wasn't a conversation.
Now, I think about that because I've seen so many, had so many in for repair that I think about that all the time. And we're trying to build stuff that does last 65 cents. I'll lose you, you know.
Yeah, well, that's not going to be that much longer.
Yeah, not much longer for you.
And for Pat, it could be before the end of the day.
You've had some parts replaced yourself, haven't you?
Once in a while, you need to have something tweaked. What are you saying?
Thank you.
Cool. Let's see. And then you brought this guy.
Yeah, a gold fill.
Yeah.
So these are. These are the old Tysco.
Yeah. Pickup. Did they use pickups like these, like in harmonies and some stuff like that? Where did they come from?
Tysco's. There was a bunch of like Norma and all these different names that they used, but this is a specific model of the Tysco. There's different versions of it. Some of them have the pole pieces running down the center, a different pickup design internally. So what we had to do here is we kept getting requests for this. I mean, the first time I met David Lindley, he said this was like 19, or it was probably 2000 or so. You make them Tysco pickups.
Yeah, because he is the Tysco guy.
Yeah, he was totally into it. He knew about it. He put the bug in my ear, the first guy, and then over the years, I think James Williamson from the Stooges sent me a Tysco pickup, and Andy Marshall from THD sent me one, and I took them apart and drew all these parts up.
What is it like underneath this?
So these are actually, they're under 3/8 of an inch deep, so you can surface mount them. Really easily. These are made so that you can put them into a P90 ring and mount them into a guitar that already has P90s. Mm-hmm. So what's under here is there's a steel plate that runs underneath the coil assembly, and it curves up, goes across and comes back down, and there's holes drilled in that steel plate that are threaded, and that's where the pole pieces go. The coil is actually over here, and the magnet...
So the coil doesn't go to where those screws go?
No. The magnet, see where those two rivets are?
Yeah.
The magnet is centered on those two rivets. So what happens is you got a steel plate underneath. So you got south up here, a north goes along a steel plate, and then comes up where these pole pieces are. So you got south and north. So you got this wide magnetic field with a real thin pancake coil.
Wow.
So you get more inductance and output from the steel plate, basically. But it uses fewer turns, so you get a clearer sound.
What kind of wire do you use on that?
That's 44 gauge wire on that, which is super small.
Yeah.
So.
And a lot of the, so I used to have some Tyscos. I think we've had them because we worked in music stores for a year, and a lot of those were really microphonic.
Yeah, I was aware of that.
You could talk into them.
I was aware of that. And that's fine. Some people like that, but most people, it's going to be too microphonic. So we pot them.
Yeah.
Don't remember how long we pot these for. 45 seconds.
The length of the potting, 40 seconds as opposed to a minute.
Right.
Is it, how does that affect the sound?
Well, what it does is basically in the minimal amount that you want to pot, you want to kind of solidify the outside of the coil. So if it gets bumped, it won't shift and expand. But if you completely pot all the way through it, it'll kill all of the microphonics, which gives it kind of a, when you're playing by yourself, you can hear these overtones, kind of sort of like a, sort of a reverb-ish sounding,
Yeah, which is good.
Yeah, yeah. Once you get a drummer in there, it's pretty hard.
Yeah, I mean, I remember playing Tyscos and thinking that it had a lot of personality to it, but, you couldn't play them very loud.
Right.
Because of that microphone business.
These you can.
Wow.
And the cool thing, one of the other things about this pickup is when you pick it really hard with a pick, it gets brighter, and when you play smoother, the top end kind of rolls off. So it really has a wide range.
You know what that reminds me of? That reminds me of a PAF.
Yeah,
it's like
right.
It's like it's right. The attack.
It's really
the attack of the pick puts you as the player of utilizing what the guitar will do without having really anything else.
And that's what I like to do with when I make pickups is make it so they're really responsive to what the player puts into it rather than the
pickup.
Why
would somebody
dominate.
Not want that?
some people like the pickup to dominate the sound,
Right.
So, but.
I can hardly wait to hear those, too. We're going to run these pickups and guitars through a couple different amps. We're going to run them through the Vox AC-10. We're going to run them through some old Fenders and kind of get a feel for what they do.
Yeah.
And then you brought. So,
we got the Imperials.
These are the Imperials. So this is kind of the flagship of the PAF thing for
Lollar. Of ours. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's our medium output set. We have a higher output.
What's the
lower
magnet,
output.
Magnet in these?
Those are A2 and A5.
Okay. A2, A5.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And they're degaussed to a specific level. Every one of them is, we go through and measure them and set them up just exactly how we want them.
Did you?
A lot of places don't do that.
Yeah.
You want to put that?
Did you compare? This is probably it. You people are making me ask these questions. I'm not like this. So when you're making these, are you comparing them to original PAFs?
Yeah. Oh, of course. Yeah. We've had
you
those.
Made me ask that.
Yeah, we've had those in many times for repair and completely functional. But that's typically what we'll do. When I'm making a new pickup design, we'll get an old one, listen to it, take it apart. Sometimes we'll have pieces of it burned so that you can do a spectrograph on it and figure out exactly what the material is. And it doesn't take a whole lot. It just takes a small amount to get a readout. We don't have that kind of machinery. We send it out to a lab. All of our stuff, like these covers, that's made in the USA. We have the screws made for us. We have the slugs made for us. We have the bobbins made for us. We have the wire made for us. In fact, a lot of these parts that you'll see, and on many of our other ones, we designed the parts and had a company stamp them for us. We didn't have to pay for the tooling, but they get to sell the parts. So that's how you see humbucker size filtertrons. That's all our design stuff. Mm-hmm. The gold foil stuff, that's our design.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. And if you go to your website, if you go to Lollar's website, which I'm running the information under the screen here, they make all kinds of stuff. You make fender stuff and all that. We're not going to get into the fender stuff on this particular show, but
we make more different kinds of stuff than anybody except for maybe Seymour Duncan or something.
Yeah. These are potted.
Those are potted for 15 seconds, I think.
How long have you been making this pickup?
Probably that model. You know, I started actually making models back probably 2000. Before that, everything was just done customer requests. I'd listen to what they wanted, and then I would build what I thought they would want. And after I got request after request after request, hundreds of them, I started figuring out, okay, some people want this, some people want that, some people want this or that, and started just making a range of stuff that would fit what most people are going to ask you for.
So we're going to come back to that in a second, because I think that's going to be an important thing. Here's the question, and Pat and I have talked about this a little bit. So let's say that you started making, or this is a model pickup that you make.
Yeah.
If somebody had purchased one of these pickups, the Lollar Imperial, when you were making them earlier, and then they bought one now, is it the same pickup?
It is the same pickup. There may have been some small changes cosmetically, but the basic specs are what they were. And I even keep a box full of pickups that we've made from past years, so that we can go and we can take a new one and compare it to the old one.
Okay.
And the other thing that we do is we keep track of, well, the magnet, the gauss, the inductance, and within a range of inductance for that model, the resistance within a range. So everything is tested over and over. And it's not just resistance. Resistance doesn't tell you much of anything about it.
Right.
The inductance, the resistance can go up or down, but the inductance is going to stay very close to the same unless...
Is that the magnetism?
It's how the magnetism responds with the coil.
And the strings.
And the strings. And
which is?
What materials are in there. You can tell if you got the wrong magnet in there. You could tell if it's a 2 or a 5, if it's not within spec of what this particular model should be.
I think Pat will agree with this, that as we started doing the show, we started going through a lot of different pickups. It seems, and here again, I don't mean to sound like a Neanderthal, but too late for that, is that this magnet business is really the big deal. I mean, it's like it's really a big deal.
It is, yeah. Different material, difference in how they're made.
Yeah.
Makes a difference in the sound.
Formula for them. Yeah. So who makes your magnets?
We have a company in Vancouver, Washington that handles all that for us. So.
Okay, so back to this idea. Because I know that you have talked about this a little bit on your website, and it is about calling up Jason Lollar and saying, I really, really like the Imperial, but I want you to use a particular kind of wire, and I want you to do this and particularly do that, which I think you are alluding to, that you used to do that a lot.
A lot,
And you, I don't think you do that anymore.
We'll do it occasionally, but I really try to suss out what is it you're trying to get.
Yeah.
And is that really going to do it for you? Because I've done that where they told me exactly how to wind the pickup and what kind of materials to use. They're thinking because they're reading something, and then they wind up getting it, and they don't always necessarily like it. Sometimes they're really disappointed.
Yeah.
You know? So I, you know, if I do it, I let them know it's on you if you don't like it. Anytime we make a model like this, sometimes it takes 10, 20 tries to get it, because we'll compare every little change that we make. We'll go back and listen to it compared to the last version.
Mm-hmm.
And if it starts going off in the wrong direction, then we have to back up and try something else. And so not everything sounds that good.
Yeah.
And so about your company, how many employees do you have? And yeah, if somebody calls and says, hey, Jason, I want this pickup, how hands are on are you with the pickups?
I don't do much of it myself anymore as far as the production area.
Because you're too old?
No. Yeah.
Whoa, time for a break.
Well, you know, sometimes you get arthritis.
Well, here's the deal, though. We have 16 now. We've had maybe as many as 18. But every guy or girl that's in there making pickups, they have to go through it takes 6 months to a year before we let them make something from start to finish. We don't have like one guy just winding coils all day long.
Right.
Whoever does it, they'll make a particular pickup from start to finish. One guy.
Okay.
And then they get to put their initials on the back of it. And they are trained so they would do it exactly the way I do it. And it's been that way for
a
long time. Mostly what I do.
That's important, I think.
Oh, totally.
That's very.
And that's the best way to get the quality, so that every pickup is, every detail of every pickup is one guy watching it. I think you get better quality that way than one guy just winding coils and throwing them in a box, you know, another guy soldering wires on. Because they really care about what they're doing.
More. Yeah, that makes
sense. And they're signing their name to it.
And they're signing their name to it. And so if something goes wrong, they get through the gauntlet, you know.
Oh, my God.
They very rare.
Sounds horrible.
That hardly anything ever goes wrong.
Here's an observation I think we have, and Pat and I, again, have talked about this, which is the player quotient that's involved in it. So you've got a guy. Let's say I'm a guy out there somewhere, which I am, and I call up and I say, yeah, so I want you to do this particular thing. And even if I think you would say, so where are you coming from? Tell me a sound. Like, what are you talking about? The variables that are involved that are not about this are through the roof.
Yeah.
It's like, so like and we make it clear if we're talking about PAF pickups, you're talking about whatever you want. What kind of amplifier do you use?
Yep.
What everything about it is about, and what is your skill level?
Yeah.
I mean,
absolutely.
Really, you just go, are you any good?
Absolutely, yeah.
Because you can have, as we know, you can have some guy who's a real pro come in, and they're going to go, and this all of a sudden, the same guitar becomes a Stradivarius.
Absolutely.
And you hand it to somebody else. And so I would think that
a lot of guys don't know how to make a good sound. They can't get one good sound out of it.
Yeah.
You know, if you can just get one sound, hit one note, and get it to speak.
Yes.
You know, that's a start.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a real good start.
You're right.
The diphthong.
Yeah, that thing.
Remember the diphthong?
You know,
Some people call it the bloom.
We keep going back to fashion.
Okay. It's a diphthong. That's the first time I've heard of that.
Yeah. It's a vocal characteristic. It's a, where you go, ow, and it changes a vowel sound.
Right.
And you can hear it on a number of recordings.
It's got a font on it.
There you go.
Yeah.
And when you hear it, every player can be looking for something a little bit different.
Yeah.
But the thing is, if you're a good player and you are playing a quality instrument, it will do things, have like an overtone series. It'll have a number of things that are personality that are being brought out. But on the same token, and we talked to this before we started filming, it's also very revealing. Revealing as in, You know, are you a race car driver?
Yeah. Or are you a truck driver?
Yeah. If you're going to get that car and take it up to 200 miles an hour and you're no good, you're going to go off the road.
Exactly.
And it doesn't matter if Jason Lollar hand makes this pickup for you with exactly whatever spec you want. You have a certain responsibility as a player to accept that responsibility. You're the nut behind the wheel.
I've heard this many times where somebody put the pickup and they go, wow, now I know how bad I am. I got to practice now.
Yeah.
That's happened. I've heard that a lot.
Nothing really wrong with that.
So that's where the, you can talk to somebody and we've developed different words for different kinds of sounds that you get.
Like what?
Oh, like quacky or...
like a strat.
Quacking like a duck, between. Spiky, that would be treble that's hurting your ears. Mm-hmm. It's too early in the morning, but I do that.
It's 4 o'clock in the afternoon.
Yeah, smoky, woody,
yeah, all those.
Throaty,
right?
Snarly.
I know you're trying to put a description of something that is not seen.
Yeah.
And is being interpreted by people's ears.
Right. Yeah. And so sometimes you got to figure out where they're coming from. But the big thing is that we know where they started and where they want to go, at least I have an idea of where to steer. But the thing is, once the guy grabs a guitar, a lot of it depends upon what kind of chord inversions they use. You know, even that.
Everything.
Just how it's stacked.
Yeah.
How they hit the attack or they don't, and a guitar can sound completely different from one guy to another. So
that's why in our guitar comparisons and pickup comparisons on the Doug and Pat show, we have Mr. Frazier playing all the time.
Right.
Because so, one guy, one guitar. Yeah.
And I try to play, even though that basically I'm a jazz player. I'm trying to play in a similar style that... If you're talking about a PAF pickup, and we've kind of harped on this, there is a particular sound and a particular tradition that comes from the players, lead guitar players, who made those guitars worth a lot of money. It's not guys who are strumming and playing Kumbaya.
Right.
So I try to play in the style that goes like that.
Kumbaya.
Mel B. That's Mel B, right?
Yeah. Either that.
Two, though.
Is it Richie Havens?
I think that you've got something going on with Richie Havens. You're funneling funds.
Richie Havens. Oh, my God.
Yeah. But anyway, the whole idea, though, is that you have to couple it up with the player.
Yeah.
And that's what we do, which is why Pat's saying, no, I'm not going to play guitar today.
I'll play the flute.
Yeah.
I'm not going to say.
Well, you know... How about the auto harp? Now, John Sebastian played an auto harp.
Can you piccolo?
Yeah. Are you saying that maybe John Sebastian would call up Jason Lollar and say, I would like to get a particular sound in my auto harp?
I want it to sound like a sunburst Les Paul.
He has a sunburst Les Paul.
I've actually made pickups for auto harps.
And
I know John Sebastian.
And here's the other thing that Jason brought, which is...
Oh, yeah, the shoe, man.
The Let's Sue Jason Lollar pickup right here. So this is a Rickenbacker bass, 4001, right?
Yeah.
And you make this.
Yeah, we make that. I don't make that. I have it made.
Yeah.
Yeah. I go to a machine shop and I do it.
If somebody ordered up, if somebody had a 4001 and they wanted to make it sound better, they could go to your website and see what it is it's about.
Yeah.
What you're trying to do on this guy.
These are actually the magnets here.
Yeah.
And that's
Did they stop using these at the Rickenbacker stop using these as magnets after a period of time and went to a different design, or they always been, this has always been a magnet?
Now that was a question during the whole trademark thing. Was it, did they ever stop using these? But now these are just steel now, the ones that the reissues they make, and the magnets are in the coil. So it's like a magnetic reflector rather than being the magnet itself.
Is this the magnet for you?
Yeah, that's the magnet. Yeah. The old Wile E. Coyote magnet where you'd, you know.
Yeah.
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 That's what they are. They're horseshoe magnets, which are, it's a little different. It's a different function than like the Alnico magnet in here. These are actually steel. They're a certain type of steel, and then they're hardened in a specific way. And then they're polished and plated, and then we magnetize them. And the way it's hardened has to do with how much magnetism it'll store and how long it'll hold it. So it's quite that was a long time, a lot of years working on that to get to where, I mean, those are just gorgeous. Look at now.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah. It sounds like, from I think what I've read on your website and all that, is that you spend a lot of time working on these pickups. How long did it take to do the gold foil pickup?
Oh, sometimes, probably from start to finish.
Yeah.
By the time all the tooling was made and everything, it's probably over a year. Sometimes it's taken almost a couple of years, because I'm not just doing that. I'm doing a whole bunch of stuff at the same time.
Yeah.
It's a lot of hours. You know, you have to draw every part up. You got to make sure once the parts come back, you got to check them, make sure everything fits. A lot of winding and listening to it and comparing it to the old one and pulling it in and out of guitars. One thing we do is we have a bunch of these Collings of the same model, and we go in and we match all the pots so that they all, we'll have two of them, same wood, same company. The pots are all matched, the caps are matched, they got the same amount of wire in it, so we can compare two different versions of what we're doing, by picking up the guitar, pick the other one up, listen to it.
Which is why we use the same guitar when we're comparing it. We have to unsolder them and, you know, and all that stuff like that.
Yeah.
But everything is exactly in the same.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're not going to unsolder the pickups from a 58 Les Paul.
Right. No.
So, okay.
Yeah.
But the idea is that most people don't have a 58 Les Paul.
Right.
And so what do they have? We're going to use something that is affordable that they can buy now and
that's
see how
similar.
Close we can get to that, because that is sort of the promise of pickups is that can you... How close can you get to a sound it is that you're looking for?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If, of course, you can identify what it is the sound you're looking for.
If you can, yeah. So the other thing that happens is, even if everything is the same and the wood's the same and it weighs about the same, one guitar can sound brighter and another one can sound darker.
Yeah.
And so once you do your comparison, you listen to it, you think you know what's happening with each different pickup that you just did, you pull them out and you swap them. And then listen to it again, and you see if the sound followed the pickups or if it stayed in that guitar.
Right.
Does that make sense?
It does. Yeah. It actually does. We did the comparison we did, we used a R7 that Pat has, gold top. That came with a Classic 57s, I think they call them.
Yeah.
That guitar sounded really good with those Classic 57s, which I am not a fan of.
Yeah.
We started swapping them out with other pickups. It actually, they sounded worse than with the Classic 57s.
Sometimes that happens.
Yeah, you know. And yet we've pulled Classic 57s out of lots of guitars. They just made the guitar sound really average.
Yeah.
And the pickup change made them sound much, much better. Go figure.
Yeah.
I mean, does the guitar have something to do with the sound?
Oh, absolutely it does.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, let's start hearing some. Let's hear some of this stuff.
So when Jason Lollar...
Who?
You are Jason Lollar.
Yeah. Last time I tried.
Goes out to play a gig.
Mm-hmm.
What does he play?
Ooh.
Oh,
what does he prefer?
This is a tie down.
Most of the time I play a 335. And
is it blonde?
It's white, actually.
Oh,
does they have them there? PAFs on it?
Pretty good.
No, it doesn't.
Picture, Jason.
No.
PAFs.
it has my standard Imperials in it, which I'm thinking about switching out to what we call the El Rayo.
Oh.
Just get a little more cut, because you know how woody a 335 is. So it depends. If I'm playing like a trio, I like it the way it is now, but if there's another guitar, I like a little bit more point on it, you know, just so you can get a different sound out of both guitars.
And do you have a preference in amplifiers?
I have all kinds of amps. I played Super Reverb more than anything in my past, and a Tweed Deluxe, a Blackface Princeton.
Oh yeah,
Reverb. I use that a lot.
Those have gotten real popular.
Yeah, it's a good club amp. You know.
Yeah.
The way you play clubs now, or you know, they have the PA all set up
right. Yeah, we used to play. So Pat and I had a band called the Heavy Metal Thunder Band years ago, and we weren't joking. And we would have stacks behind. It's a miracle we can hear anything at all.
You know, I used to play through Ampeg V4.
Oh, geez.
God, it was so loud.
And then I bought this little Masco amp, a little MA-17, I think, about the size of a Tweed Deluxe. And it was like you pick it up with your little finger and you take it to the club, and it was just perfect. And I never went back to a big amp. And that was like 1978.
Jeez, how old are you?
I started playing clubs when I was like 17.
So,
I'm 10 years younger than you guys.
Yeah, I started playing clubs when I was a sophomore in high school. So that was right right after World War One.
Yeah, that was in the 30s, wasn't it?
It was in the 20s.
Using a horseshoe pitch.
That's where I was hauling them out of steel guitars. Let's play something.
All right.
The gold foils, is that what we call them, the
gold foils?
I'm calling them the gold foils.
Yeah.
Gold foils through a 65 deluxe reverb. Top end happening there.
Yeah.
Whoa, that's that guy right there. It sounds a lot more top endy than the like a regular P90 does.
Oh yeah.
It's like it's definitely
it doesn't have that as big of a mid range bump in it.
Yeah.
It's almost like a Strat kind of a sound almost.
Yeah. Let's hear it through the Vox. Foils through the Vox. Neck pickup.
Thank you.
Getting a little goofy. All right, staple pickup. It's down a little bit from the strings on there, so you probably messed around with this.
Yeah.
So, do you guys actually do that? Mess around with them at all at your place where you have them? You put them in and then mess around with them, or you just have one of your minions put them in there and then you just
no. I'm usually the one that's getting the hands on the guitar and dig that. These are the Lollar Imperials, which, as we know, are modeled after the PAF. Yep.
What we're looking for in these, since Jason's sitting right here, is we're looking for that articulation of attack. We're looking for the overtone series. We're looking for the bloom. We're looking for the clarity. That's what we're looking for.
Yeah.
No big deal.
Yeah.
And this is in a Callings guitar, treble pickup.
Mm-hmm.
Jason, and we have to say thanks for bringing these guitars up.
Yeah, absolutely.
And these are down. You're in Seattle, and great hearing them and all that stuff. So, for you guys out there, you have to go to Jason's website. It is so deep with stuff about pickups and development and all that stuff. How often do you guys update the blog thing?
Oh, you know, we try to do it monthly, but it doesn't always work. You know, we're totally redoing the site, and there's going to be more information on it than there is also now.
And you have demos on there. Yeah. So that's the thing we want to encourage is for you guys to go and find out what's going on there because it's fabulous. And on that note, you can also go to our own website, thedougandpatshow.com. And what you can find there are going to be all shows. You're going to be able to find merchandise that you're going to want to have. We've shipped stuff all over the world. Pat, you know, I shipped out 4 t-shirts and 4 hats to Thailand last week.
Right.
And in the same shipment, I sent out stuff to Australia. Those would be 2 places that you will never go unless you're on that slope. Pat doesn't fly.
Oh. And yeah. I've never been written up in a magazine either.
Yeah. Other than the Police Gazette. So anyway, thanks, guys. Thanks, Jason. I'm Doug.
And this is Jason. And I'm Pat.
And I'm Doug.
And I'm Pat. Okay. And I'm here.
See you next time.
Bye.
Later.